in incentive travel, we are creating an opportunity for them to have one of the major pillar experiences of their lives. And the responsibility that comes along with that is really heavy as well. But that's what I love about the industry. It's such a special opportunity to impact the lives of the travelers that are going to come to the destination.
All right. While everyone's sending in where they're coming from, before we go ahead and get started, I just want to take this opportunity to thank everyone for joining and welcoming you to today's Armchair Conversations, Incentive Travel Opportunities for Destinations in 2020. I'm Erin Goldblush, and on behalf of Site, I'd like to thank you for joining us today. So with that, I'd like to pass things over to Tahira. She's the head of events for Site, and we'll be able to kick things off our conversation today with Adam. So take it away, Tahira.
All right. Thank you, Erin. It's always fun to be here. Now, of course, if you were looking, if you registered and you were following the advertising, then you would have thought that today's, I was going to be Parik today. Parik is our chief marketing officer, but he had other grandfatherly duties today. So I'm stepping in, and I'm so excited, Adam, to have you here today. You are sort of 1 foot into the incentive travel industry and 1 foot firmly planted in the destination marketing industry. And I think that this is going to be just a fantastic conversation with your perspective. So it's great that you are here. Our objective today is we're going to gain some perspective and some context about destinations and really just look at the work that we're doing through a wider lens. And you really offer that wider lens. So you do a few things. You've written a great book we're going to talk about called Touchpoint. You have a podcast, which I've been listening to, the Destination Marketing Podcast, really enjoying that. So today you're going to be on the other side. So I'm going to ask you questions today, and welcome.
I'm excited. Thanks a lot. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. And I do want to let everybody know that I'm kind of coming out of a cold here. And so I may have to mute and cough here and there and drink a lot of water in the process, but I'll do my best to shield everybody from having to hear too much of that.
And we appreciate that, Adam. So this, of course, now we can't sneeze or cough or even have an allergy anywhere. So this is part of our new world. So that's why we have this fantastic mute button.
That's
so
right.
And so what we're going to be looking at, Adam, is a whole range across the work that you do. So I thought we could start first with the advertising agency and advertising industry in general. So, of course, probably me and most of our audience have watched Mad Men. So it's about the, you know, advertising industry on Madison Avenue, New York in the 1960s, you know, sharp suits and those long boozy lunches, girls in the typing pool, or the executive office, you know, wherever we might end up. What it mostly does, though, is it really highlights the creative process behind the advertising, the pitches, the slogans, the taglines. It's glamorous and sexy and alluring. It's all of those things we love about advertising. And now you've worked in an advertising agency for about a dozen years. So what is it that attracted you, besides all those obvious, very alluring things that I've just mentioned, to that world?
Yeah, you know, it was interesting how I got into advertising. And you know, Mad Men definitely took some creative liberties there. And also it was a different era of advertising. But, you know, the thing that kind of led me to advertising, my dad is a college professor and he teaches public relations and media ethics. And so as I went through college and I went to Brigham Young University, I first tried journalism and took some journalism classes. And one of the professors said, well, you just need to be prepared. There's no money in it. And that was enough for me to say, I probably need to switch to something else. And then I took the intro to PR class and I just, it didn't have the excitement that I was looking for in my career. And so kind of as a last ditch effort, and really a lot of this had to do with, at the same time, my wife, my now wife, told me if I didn't figure out what I was going to do with my life, she wasn't ready to get married, and she wanted somebody that kind of knew where things were going. And I happened to take the intro to advertising class right around the time we had that conversation. And I really fell in love with that class, fell in love with the industry. And I've literally never looked back. And you know, I think she's happy too that we chose that path. And really, advertising, the thing that I love about it is that I get to use every part of my brain, if that makes sense. You know, I like to write. I like to speak. I like to be creative. And I feel like I get to touch every part of my brain in advertising.
You know, I understand that. So I want to ask you just obviously, you know, events are really just a live way of bringing that marketing and advertising to life. So I, you know, kind of dip into your world a little bit, but I'm more on the experience side. So when you're really doing advertising though, do you ever feel that sort of that moral conflict of, you know, it's about spin or presenting something different than what it might actually be? Or, you know, sometimes, you know, with the example, we're looking sort of at not destinations, but cosmetics, you know, obviously you will have this image of perfection once you've tried this new thing. And once we go to a destination, we'll have this amazing new life and transformative. So what do you think about that when you're delving into destination marketing?
What you're asking is an important question, especially one that was important for me as I was deciding what to do with my career. And you know, in advertising, there definitely is or can be an ethical dilemma. And my opinion is if you're passionate about and believe in the things that you're advertising, that ethical dilemma shouldn't be there. And so, for example, the first 5 years of my career, I did a lot of automotive advertising. And you know, I think there's a lot of good people in the automotive industry, specifically a lot of the people that I ended up dealing with, there were a lot of ethical questions that came up along the way, right? What they wanted me to put in an advertisement versus what they were willing to offer the customer when the customer actually came in, right? And some of the conversations I heard, I kind of vowed once I got out of automotive advertising that I wouldn't do it again, because authenticity in advertising is really important. And we'll talk about that today, I'm sure. But for me personally, it's also very important. And I wouldn't want to put my name on something that I didn't firmly believe in. And tourism, that may be why we've ended up in tourism, because it is not hard to find amazing value in every tourism destination in the world. And every destination has an audience. And that audience is going to find incredible value at the destination. So if we find the right audience and the message is authentic, there is no ethical dilemma on whether or not we should be pushing that message to the audience.
I agree. And you know what? It's just, I think all of us right now are really missing travel, you know? And so it is, it's about what did that, you know, what lived up to it for us and how did we feel when we actually got there versus sort of the hype that was around it. And so when we start to look at, you know, that really that tourism advertising, you know, I love looking at how destinations have marketed historically, how destinations and countries and cities are positioned, how they partner together. You know, there's a lot of alliances that we see in the world of, you know, come here and here and we'll make that work for you. And, you know, we have people that we know who are collect those vintage posters of destination campaigns. And, you know, I think about a lot of the work that I've done has been in Western Canada and in Banff and Lake Louise and that area. And quite often during an event that we're doing, one of those events is around the history of the area and, you know, the trains and how the, you know, it really was build it and they will come by train because of course they were built that when that was the primary mode of travel. So, and they seem, you know, really like so glamorous and now a little bit quaint. So I'd love to hear a little bit about some of the destination marketing campaigns that you've worked on, you know, some of your favorites.
Yeah. You know, we've worked on a lot and I'll talk about some of those, but I'm also going to talk about some that I feel like are even better than maybe some of the things that we've done that I kind of aspire to, and I'll talk about both of those. One of my favorite campaigns that we've done, and it's because it was one of the early ones, and we had the opportunity to solve a difficult problem. So we work with Bryce Canyon Country, which is Garfield County, Utah. And, you know, when they came to us, the challenge that they had is that Bryce Canyon was one stop for most people on a 5 national park tour where they'd hit the Grand Canyon, they'd go to Yellowstone and they'd hit several other places, right? And so the problem that they had was not volume of traffic. The problem was people were coming and only staying for one night. But if you've been to that area, there is also the Grand Staircase Escalante National Monument. There's 2 major scenic byways in that destination. And you literally could spend 2 weeks there and not even scratch the surface on all the amazing experiences you could have. And so they said, we need your help, not getting more people here, but getting people to come and spend multiple nights and understand how much there is to do. And, you know, we really brainstormed a lot as an agency to try to figure out what's the right message for that. And as we did that, we advertising, they talk a lot about say it without saying it, right? Find a way to say it without saying it. Well, this one, we decided, no, let's be very straightforward. And the campaign was titled Take Your Time. And basically we would feature Bryce Canyon, but then all of the amazing additional activities that surrounded Bryce Canyon. And the entire message was based around, if you don't take your time, you're not even experiencing a fraction of what you could experience by being here. And we have seen, you know, that was in 2014, and we have seen almost every year double-digit growth year over year in tax revenue generated. And in the years that weren't double digits, they were still single-digit growth year over year, and we've outperformed the industry in that growth. And so that was a great campaign. Another one of my favorites, and a lot of these, you know, I go back to kind of some of our early ones because they were kind of special to me. In I was also discovering the tourism industry at the time and understanding it. And so I learned a lot in those times. But there's a place called Vernal, Utah, and they have Dinosaur National Monument. And it is this incredible, probably the most iconic part of it is this incredible place called the Wall of Bones. And it's this mountain face where they have kind of brushed and carved away the rock. And you see literally hundreds of dinosaur bones on this rock face. And it's a pretty amazing discovery that they had. And so, you know, the thing that was the problem with that amazing place was that it doesn't photograph very well. The lighting in there isn't very good. So we could create this amazing message, this amazing ad, and then the photography would not do it justice. And so we thought, how can we bring this to life? How can we make this more interesting? And we decided to animate some characters. And instead of creating, you know, just photography, we used illustration and animation to bring those dinosaurs to life. And that turned into a children's book. It turned into a video that we did. And we've done new books and stories every year since. And, you know, the core dinosaurs that we use, one's named Vern, one's named Al, and it spells Vernal when you put them together, right? And it's their adventures experiencing all that there is to do in the destination. The campaign's called Origin of Adventure. And the idea is that the reason you find all the dinosaur bones in Vernal is because they had such an amazing time. The dinosaurs were having so much fun. That's where they chose to live and die. And so the campaign's called The Origin of Adventure. And that was a really, really fun campaign as well.
And it sounds like it's still fun.
Oh, we love it. And it really has been fun to see it evolve as time's gone on. Not to use a word that may not be very helpful to the dinosaurs, evolve. But it's been fun to watch it evolve over time. And then I'll talk about one that I wish I had done, and one that's really been impactful on me. And a great example to me of how to know you've come up with a great campaign. I had these guys on my show to talk about the campaign fairly early on. But this is the state of Idaho. They have a campaign called 18 Summers. And I'm not sure how many people here have seen it. But the main point of the campaign is that you have 18 summers with your children, and then they're gone. So you have 18 years of opportunity to create amazing experiences with your kids, and then they're gone. And I have four children. And for me, there's been very few ads that I've ever seen that have made me emotional or want to be a better father, want to change who I am as a person. And I can honestly say that campaign made me rethink everything about my approach to fatherhood and, you know, what that means in general. And man, that's impactful. Like, there's one level of advertising, which is kind of will get your attention, right? The next level is inspiring someone to actually take action. And I really admire what the 18 Summers campaign has done for the state of Idaho. And their numbers prove that it's been a very, very effective campaign.
I love those. I think Colleen has just put a note into the chat that she worked for Grand Traverse Resort in Traverse City, Michigan for years, and the Pure Michigan campaign was phenomenally successful for us in the people's eyes to show how diverse the state is and what it offers. And I think that's a great example. You know, I love like Branson, Missouri. It's not your grandma's Missouri. And they always do like the trade shows now. They always have like really good ice cream stands. So that's always, you know, it's fun for me because I love ice cream. So I'm happy to take morning and afternoon ice cream breaks. And I also like what you were saying around Bryce Canyon. So a couple of years ago, before I started with Site, I had quit my job and I spent about almost 6 months traveling. And during that time, I had a point where I had gone to New Zealand and Australia. And then my daughter said, well, I have some time. She was 18. She said, I could come to, you know, New Zealand. Or I said, well, I already have been there. So pick anywhere else in the world. And so that's on that side of the world. And so we spent, when she was 18 years old, that last year that you can take your children and go traveling. We had some amazing adventures with our family. But just the two of us went to Bali and spent 3 weeks. And, you know, day three, she's like, I need some alone time. I'm like, you need some alone time. It was a really special, time, and it really gave us the opportunity to grow from that, you know, somewhat combative teenage mother relationship that is inevitable to a really nice place now. That, and she's, you know, in her third year of university, and, you know, we can have really open conversations, and we don't have those same barriers that we had when she was in high school, and, you know, travel did that. But as part of that summer, when I came back, I was speaking in Denver and then in Salt Lake City. And so my husband met me in Denver and we rented a car and we drove and did that tour through Utah with Bryce Canyon and Capitol Reef. And we didn't make it to Antelope, but we did make it to Zion. And you're right, it's an incredibly special part of the world. And I just want to go back and spend more time there. But I love Bryce, just looked like this massive pipe organ. I just thought it was you know, I think that what people don't realize when you think about going to somewhere like the canyons of Utah, you think that's new, you've seen a canyon, you've seen them all. And that's not the case at all, because every canyon is so incredibly, vastly different and incredibly beautiful in its own way. And it's, of course, very well structured to travel, to be a tourist, you know, to have those experiences, whether you're with your family. It would be an amazing trip to do with your family, because there's just so many hikes and monuments and places that inspire discussion and dialogue. And I think that's an important part of travel as well. So I think those are great examples.
Well, you bring up something that really, you're going to get me kind of on my soapbox now for the tourism industry. And really, I think Site and incentive travel, this is really important for incentive travel as well, because the thing that I love about tourism, and you touched on this with your experience with your daughter, is that, you know, at the end of everybody's life, you will have a handful of memories. Like if somebody asked you, okay, tell me what your life was like. Tell me the experiences you had in your life. You know, you lived hopefully 70, 80 years, 90 years, right? What are the experiences that stand out as you're going to describe your life? What were the high points of your life? And in travel, we have the opportunity to create an experience that is so impactful that it would be on the list of descriptions of your life at the end of your life, right? And you, the experience that you had with your daughter, that is a big experience for you. I mean, you said it broke down barriers between you and your daughter, right? And so in incentive travel, we're using incentive travel to incentivize people's performance or however we're using incentive travel, we are creating an opportunity for them to have one of the major pillar experiences of their lives. And the responsibility that comes along with that is really heavy as well. But that's what I love about the industry. It's such a special opportunity to impact the lives of the travelers that are going to come to the destination.
So think about my job, Adam. I am the head of events for Site. So my job is to create those events you've just mentioned for other event professionals.
No pressure.
But I love it. And I think, you know, that's what is so, we are so fortunate to be able to create those life-changing moments for people. And what I love about what we get to do when we are, you know, essentially creating, you know, every event that we do, it's about, you know, learn, connect, discover, and discover being that focus on the destination. And when we get to partner with our destinations to really drive the incentive portion of that message home and bring it to life and show people what they can do that they could then bring their own groups to experience to create those memories. And we're so lucky to be able to do that. And all of us can't wait to be meeting live again instead of talking about it. But you're exactly right. It's those touch points that change what we're doing. And I just want to, Daniela just put a great I asked for people if they had great examples in the chat, and it was the campaign by MNC Saatchi Group for Promote Island in Iceland. And so it was this idea that, you know, we all just want to scream right now. And so the viewers were invited, you probably saw this, to record their screams, and then they were collecting the screams and then taking them to this remote Icelandic destination and letting our screams of frustration go. And I just, you know, it does make me want to go to Iceland and just do it live, of course. But what a great, you know, what a smart way to do that, to bring something to life.
I love that example, because I also feel like coronavirus in general, a lot of people have looked at it as, oh my gosh, I can't believe this is happening. This is so hard. This is so terrible. But Iceland and the Saatchi group that came up with the campaign for Iceland instead said, this is an opportunity to innovate and differentiate, right? And I think people that were proactive in COVID, and COVID is by no means over, right? But people that are using this crisis as an opportunity to take a step forward and innovate are the ones that are going to be winners when whatever this new normal is going to be is established, because they took action and used the opportunity to expand their brand versus hibernating and waiting for all this to be over. If the crisis is happening to you, then you've already lost. If you're attacking the crisis, you know you're in the right place.
You know, that is, I love that. And that really sets me up for my next question that I want to ask you, which is, you know, you started your own agency after you bought what was a well-established company that you worked for and have carried it on. So tell me about how you felt. Was it like, what was it like when you first went out on your own versus how are you feeling now that everything has shifted? When you do, obviously, you know, you have other clients and areas that you focus on, but of course, destination, you're rooted in that destination. So tell us about that experience and now.
Yeah, you know, it was interesting. I think at every stage of my career, I've thought I know more than the person who was managing me. And then I get in their role and say, oh crap, I was wrong. And then I see the people that frustrate me and they're doing things that was exactly what I did to my boss, you know? And so I was one of those, and I think ignorance is really good when you're taking risks, because I think if you know the risk that you're actually taking, you'd be much more hesitant. And when I was working in this agency back in 2015, I looked at some of the decisions that were being made by the previous owner, and ignorant me said, I could do this better, you know, and it got to the point to where I said, you know, my role was bringing in new clients for the agency and making sure that the clients that we brought in were taken care of. And I felt like I was having a very, very major impact on the agency. And I felt like, and once again, a big portion of this is that I was ignorant, but I felt like if I owned the agency, I could do it better. And so I went to the previous owner and I said, hey, I feel like I may be more passionate about this than you at the time. He had his hand in many other interests, you know. And I said, how about I buy this from you? And it's funny because I didn't even know how I was going to come up with the money when I had that conversation with him, right? And so I, you know, oh, hey, I'll buy it, right? But I don't have any money to buy it. And you know, he and I started a conversation and he was interested. And then I had to go figure out how to pay the largest amount of money that had ever been a part of my life to buy the agency from him. And I found a bank that was willing to take a chance and give me an SBA loan. I went to one of my one of my good friends from high school that he had some money put away that I needed help with the down payment on that loan. And he's still a partner in the business today. And we paid him off for that, which is a big, was a big milestone for us in the process. But I give you all that background because at the time I felt really optimistic. I felt like, oh yeah, like this is going to be easy. And it wasn't easy at all. We bought the business and, you know, the analogy I like to use, and this is very dramatic and not accurate, but it's like a lot of people like to build the bus from the ground up, you know, and start with the engine and then put the wheels on and the exterior. And for me, the bus was rolling downhill on fire. There was no driver in the driver's seat. And I jumped in and tried to get in and steer the bus as it was moving. And so it was a, I found out how much I didn't know about, you know, accounting, HR, all the different things that you need to know when you're running a business. But it has been such a rewarding experience, and I've grown so much over the last 4 years. And this is a real paradox that I feel like most people struggle with a little bit, that for me, I've learned a lot from. And if something is a big risk, one of the best things you can do is take that risk, because you grow so much in the process. And yes, things can go wrong. Like, we could have failed. We could have, you know, that's a big loan that we had to take out, and we could have defaulted on that loan. The agency could have gone out of business. But because we took that risk and believed that we could do it, you know, I've grown more as a person over the last 4 or 5 years than maybe in the entire time prior to making that decision. And so it's been a wild ride. And COVID, you know, I remember when President Trump announced that he was shutting down travel from China to the U.S. That was on like March 16th or something like that. And I remember thinking, I could lose my business, you know, and I felt like, because of the challenging experiences we had had early on in purchasing the business and learning what we needed to learn, I knew that I couldn't just sit back and let the crisis happen to me, right? And so we decided early on, we're going to attack this crisis. We're going to make every adjustment we can, from working with our landlord to try to figure out, hey, if things go bad, what are you going to do to help us? And going to our employees and saying, hey, we need more from you than we ever have, because we don't want to have to lay anybody off or anything like that. And because we did those things early, we have not laid anyone off as a result of COVID. And we've taken advantage of many of the government programs that are out there, including the, in the U.S. they had what's called the Paycheck Protection Program. We took advantage of that, and we just did everything we could to attack the crisis. And because of that, we're coming out of the crisis, even though it's not over. We feel like we're more in the driver's seat today in the industry than we were when it started, because of the proactive actions that we've taken.
Which is fantastic, because we're all living it. So everyone is seeing all of those things that you've said. So it's every day. So let's talk about the work that you're doing and the book that you wrote. So I'm going to put the name of the book in the chat. It's called Touchpoints, A Destination Marketer's Guide to Brand Evaluation and Enhancement. Now, first of all, I love that, you know, you have an agency, and that with that agency, this is what you do. And so you basically said, here's what we do, here's how we do it, please go forth, and could more people please do this, and here's a guide to doing that, which is fantastic. So tell me a little bit about the book, and you know that you've already published your first book. You're so young and you have 4 children. How did you have time to write a book?
Well, you know, some people might look at what I did and say, oh, he cheated. I would say it's efficiency, right? But the thing that I did that really made a difference was, a year and a half ago, I started a podcast. And here's the problem that I have, and you mentioned it, like I'm 37 and I've written a book and I've got a podcast, I've got this company. The problem that I had is, I would walk into these pitches and people would look at me and immediately decide, there's no way he has the industry experience that I'm looking for. He's, you know, 33 years old at the time. And so what I decided is, I've got to create a credibility piece that shows that I know what I'm talking about, right? And that's where the podcast came from. So we started the podcast a year and a half ago. And the thing that was amazing about it is, I've built relationships through that podcast that people would have never answered the phone if I just called and said, hey, can we have a conversation? But if I call and say, hey, I'd like to have you as a guest on my show, it's the same conversation we would have had if we chatted without the podcast. But now I record it, I publish it, and they give really amazing insights. And so what I realized about 6 months into that podcast is, I'm learning more doing this podcast than I ever did before, because I'm talking to so many brilliant people in the industry.
It's true. I mean, I think that's one of the fantastic things about having a podcast, and why I love doing these conversations. I was not disappointed at all that Parik was busy today, and that I got to talk to you, because I love learning from, you know, it doesn't matter how much we think we know, there's always something to be learned from a different perspective and from the other people that are around. I mean, 7 billion people in the world, there's a lot of information out there. So it's, yeah. Which I think is good.
Well, and you've written a book.
I've written a book, yes.
Tell us about your book.
So you did it. I did the opposite process of you. You know, you worked with a writer and used the information you had from your podcast and created. You've got worksheets in your book so that people can go through and do brand marketing worksheets, which I think is really smart. I love that. Yeah. So mine was I was trying to find something that I had written one day and I couldn't find it. And I thought, this is ridiculous that I write things for other people all the time. And I just want to take what I think is important. In events right now, which was 2 years ago. They're still important, but it's called intentional event design. And so it looks at some of the processes that go into creating and designing great experiences from a neuroscience, like I've showed up with my brain perspective. So how do we integrate technology because it's everywhere? How do we, you know, create seating design and space flow and entrances and exits and wellness into our programs? And again, just going back to that, really, humans are going to arrive one by one at your event and they're all a little bit different, but yet we need to create a group experience. So how do we do that? And a lot of it is just, you know, here's something to try. Here's something else to try. It's not, you know, here's everything that's right or wrong. There's not right or wrong. Events are events. And they have so many facets. And I feel like it's like that with destinations too. So, you know, one of the things that we were talking about was, you know, when you have a destination that is obviously, they're all different. They're a massive mix of people that, and a place can be populated by thousands or tens of thousands or millions of different people. So how do you give a destination that is very diverse a brand like you would an organization or a corporation?
Well, and that's a really good question. And it goes back a little bit to the premise of my book. And I feel like your book and my book are very similar. We're just talking about different things, but what we're trying to help somebody get to is pretty similar. You want someone to be able to have a great event and you're giving them all the tools that they need to have a great event, right? And I want for destinations to have a great brand and provide a great experience for their audience that's coming to the destination. So I think they're very aligned there. My book was built on the premise that a brand, I actually heard this at the Utah Tourism Conference in 2015. There was one of, in fact, he's been a guest on my podcast. His name's Tom Love. He was one of the most well-accoladed people in the Utah advertising industry. Owns an agency here in Utah, and a brilliant guy. And he said, and it really stood out to me, he said, a brand is the sum of all the touch points an organization has with the outside world. And as I've gone through my learning experience in the tourism industry, one of the things that I realized is that there's a lot of destinations that have a really fragmented brand. And the reason is the challenge that you are talking about when you say, you know, you've got all these different businesses within a destination, all these different attractions, all these different factors or touch points, right, that a visitor can have. How can you brand a destination as a whole? And this is what I really get into in my book, because destinations are unique in that they don't have control over all the different touch points. However, a well-run destination educates its stakeholders in such a way that they do start to have that control. And so what I talk about in my book is I give kind of the foundational elements that need to be in place. For example, you need to understand your customer experience. You need to understand who your visitors are and why they want to come to your destination, and get some of those foundational things out of the way. And then we go through each touch point, and that can be, you know, your website, that can be a billboard advertisement, it can be a digital ad, and then it can be your interaction with a waiter in a restaurant. You know, one of the examples that I give in the book is I went to Knoxville, Tennessee as a tourist, right? And when I was in Knoxville, I was at this amazing restaurant called Stock and Barrel, incredible burgers. It was amazing. And at the end of the meal, I said to my waiter, I said, hey, we'd love to look at a dessert menu. I feel like we're in Knoxville. We got to experience your dessert. And he looked at me and he said, hey, you know what? We've got great dessert here. But if you really want to experience Knoxville, you need to go to the Cruz Family Farm Creamery around the corner and get ice cream. And that had such an impact on me, because what he was doing was operating as a component of the destination, as opposed to, hey, we're Stock and Barrel, we only sell Stock and Barrel products. And so what I've tried to do is just talk about that restaurant as much as I can in my book and my podcast to make sure that they get their money back for diverting us to another business. But that's an example of a very good touch point within the destination that's out of the destination's control. But because they have a great relationship and they've helped the restaurant within the destination understand how they fit into the big picture of the customer experience, they're all aligned. And so my book gives them the tools they need to align all of those touch points together and educate their stakeholders. And the worksheet at the end is very simple. It just says, okay, what was our letter grade? A, B, C, D, F, what's the letter grade for that touch point? Who needs to be involved to improve it? And when's the kickoff meeting to plan the improvement? And that's it. And then we go from there.
I feel like most good ideas are pretty simple. We don't need to make it more complicated than that. So, and I think that, you know, what you just said is very valuable because we have, you know, much of our membership is people who are ultimately marketing a destination. So they could be destination management companies, the destinations themselves, hotel or resort sales, small agencies, large agencies. Ultimately, we are, though, as you just said, you know, by sending people off to get ice cream, it is about that destination sell. Yeah. So I think that you have a lot to teach our members about destination marketing, and obviously two great resources with the podcast and the book. So
I would definitely suggest. Let me ask you, Tahira, if you don't mind, can I ask you a quick question, Tahira? So,
yeah.
So with incentive travel, understanding, you know, the incentive travel is actually a pretty important touch point for a destination. You know, how do you guys engage destinations to make sure that your itinerary that you're giving this person with the incentivized travel fits into the destination's brand effectively?
That is a good question. So I can look at it from so many different perspectives, you know, because I've been agency selling multiple destinations. I've worked at destination management companies and now with Site and really focusing on incentive travel. You know, every time that we host an event as Site, so we are bringing in a group of buyers and a group of our sponsor partners who are truly influencers globally in incentive travel. And when we go to any destination, it has to be about creating that experience that is going to be an incentive level experience that is going to entice people to want to come back and bring their own programs back. And we don't go back to destinations. We might not go back for 6 years or 10 years or maybe ever to a specific destination because the world is full of amazing places that we can go. So I always look at it as every time that I go in and do a program in any destination, what is the legacy we're leaving behind? And how can we build on that legacy? How can we make sure that people understand that every partner that we are working with in that destination understands how they fit into the whole and how they can be part of creating that greater experience? And it's having those discussions at the beginning, before we've committed to a destination, understanding whether that's through conversations or a site inspection process, but really truly understanding what the mutual benefit is. You know, why do we want to bring people there? And how can we help them grow and share their message from that point? Because incentive travel really is just, it's like travel up, right? You've got to level it up a bit.
Yeah.
Because we're using incentive travel as a reward and recognition tool. And oftentimes organizations will use it as reward, recognition, experience, and ultimately a recruitment tool. You know, it becomes one of the elements if you're really trying to attract your high-performing personnel. They're going to be looking for a place where they're going to be rewarded for the work that they do that's not just a cash sort of reward. That's one piece of the reward system. So, and it's about making sure that people understand that they really feel recognized and special and that they've experienced something that they couldn't experience on their own. So,
can I add to that?
Yeah.
Is that okay? So yes. One of the things that I love about incentive travel is that, so as a business, you have a brand, right? Every business has a brand. Mm-hmm. And one of those touch points is how you treat your employees, right? And it's one thing to give somebody an incremental raise, like you know, here's 3% cost of living increase. Great. That doesn't really get anybody super excited, right? And you know, some people maybe it does, but I would say on a general level, I think that's what employees have come to expect. Now, if I'm giving you on an annual basis, if you perform, this experience that, once again, I'm going to go back to that bucket list and say, okay, as I look back on my life, what are those pillar experiences? And I'm giving them one of those experiences. That touch point that I'm giving that employee is going to be associated with my business forever, right? And so I think incentive travel is a pretty amazing touch point for any business to use to have to create employee loyalty. And I mean, not only that, and yes, there's what it gives the business, but also what more could you give one of your employees than an experience they'll never forget?
What, and that's exactly it, right? Like, what more can you give? Nothing is going to be more meaningful or more rewarding. And I think that, you know, right now we're in a time where everyone's trying to, you know, look at how can we, you know, create some kind of tangible moment with virtual experience. It's never going to replace the incentive travel experience. It's, you know, it's the substitute we need to have right now. And it's, that's the way that it is. But it is about how do we get, when, as we start to go back into events, and we're starting to see some live events, we're starting to see some really successful small incentives, you know, where people know that they're coming in safe, they can stay in their bubble, they can still go out and do these amazing experiences. And sometimes it's nice to do it in a smaller group because you actually get more of that deeper interaction and time with your executives that you wouldn't get to have otherwise. And that becomes part of that overall experience. So I just want to go up to our audience and just see if anybody has any questions so far that they want to ask. But if not, I have more questions. So first of all, is there going to be a second book?
So yes, there is going to be a second book. And it definitely will be relating to this crisis that we're all trying to navigate right now. I don't want to give too much away, but what I'm trying to do is take multiple crises that have happened in the tourism industry over the years, take the key learnings from each of those crises and put them together into a preparation guide of, okay, next time something like this happens, what's steps 1 through 20, right? And I want to make sure that people have the tools that they need. In fact, I'll point back to, I did an episode with Ventura, California on the Destination Marketing Podcast. And they talked about how they had a fire in their destination. And that fire was their first attempt at using their crisis communications plan that they had put together. And so because they had already had that trial run, one of the things that they did in that process was they created a Facebook group for all of their stakeholders within the destination. So restaurants, hotel owners, key political figures, all these people. And so when coronavirus hit, they already had that Facebook group created. They communicated to their people immediately, right? And that's just one example, but because of the previous crisis, they were prepared for the next one. And so what I want to do with my next book is make sure that everybody's prepared for the next crisis. So that's where I'm headed right now. And you know, we've got a lot going on. We're in the process of making some major moves with our business that's taking a lot of time. So I would imagine we're probably close to January before that book gets out. But that's what I'm working on right now.
I feel like January is a pretty fast timeline, actually. So I'm just going to put it out there now. We'd like to have you back when it's out and okay. To walk through some of that crisis management with people. I think that's a really valuable exercise, one we all wish weren't ever going to need, but practically speaking, we've all been through enough now, you know, SARS, 9/11, H1N1, blah, you know, goes on and on. So it's it is something that being prepared does help. I don't think any of us truly could possibly have been prepared for what's happening right now. But, you know, so we, as SITE, we call ourselves the Small But Mighty Association. So, you know, well above 2,000 members, 30 chapters around the world, truly global, which is awesome when I get to, you know, when we do our events, because for me, it generally is about midnight and 8 a.m. that we're starting events. So, but we are promoting travel as the ultimate workplace reward. So as we've just talked about, and with that, you know, the bucket list travel experiences, which you mentioned, going to those destinations, it is about sustaining high performance in our key personnel and really keeping that talent feeling really special. And obviously this is just, it's been changing and changing and changing, and how do we go forward? So when you are working with your destinations and you know, whether, and these destinations could be anywhere, because what travel, of course, brings is access to other cultures. It brings another way of life. It allows you to enrich your own life by connecting with people who are in local destinations, as well as the people that you're traveling with, because you're getting to see them in a different light and to share different experiences with them. So how are you seeing destinations as you're working with them, becoming more aware of those power, not just the leisure and FIT travel experiences, but the group and travel and incentive travel experiences?
Yeah, you know, one of the things that I think is interesting is for destinations to understand who they are, right? There's some destinations, in fact, I've talked to some that have always been great leisure destinations, but they've really wanted to have that group travel component, right? In fact, I talked to, goodness, I'm having a hard time. I've had so many guests. I've had 90 episodes of my show, so it's hard to remember the names of everybody that came on. But there was one destination that came on, and she talked about how in their destination, they were really going to travel on leisure, but they had always wanted a convention center, and they were really pushing it with their leadership and everything. And as they went through that process, coronavirus hit, and they didn't get their convention center. And they now, because all like major events and things like that have shut down, these guys have come out ahead of all their neighboring destinations who they were jealous of that had a convention center, right? And so I think one of the things that destinations need to understand is who they are at their core. And if you have a great experience, identify what that amazing experience is and share that. Don't try to shoehorn yourself into something you're not, because remember, you're only going to provide that bucket list experience if you're being authentic to what the destination is, because if the message doesn't match the experience, what you're dealing with is a disappointed visitor and a disappointed company if we're doing incentive travel, because their employee didn't have the experience that they hoped they would have, right? And then as it pertains to like incentive travel specifically, I think every destination needs to come up with what their core best all-star experience is for visitors, right? And so that when somebody like site or comes to the destination and says, okay, we want to send a group here, what's the best experience they can have? It's not, oh, let me talk to my partners and I'll pull that together. It's, here is the best way to experience our destination. They will not regret it if they do it this way. And so there's some proactive work that needs to be done by destinations to understand that for this target audience, this is the very best experience for them, and match the people to the experience in the best way that they can.
So here's, I'm going to challenge that. So having spent a lot of time working for destination management companies, so there's two things. One, I would say that absolutely destinations need to have a really good understanding of what is special in their destination and unique and off the charts, exciting for people. I think that it's also working with the destination management companies, who are the ones who are also actively out selling and marketing to the incentive travel buyers and the agency buyers. And it changes so quickly what you can do in your destination. And of course, if you Google, you know, rooftop dining, you'll get, you know, these amazing things that will come up on your tourism website quite often. But they're not all good for groups. So it's about really the destination management companies who understand how to manage and provide those high-level experiences. Also clearly understanding, not even just the new normal rules, but understanding, you know, if somebody says you can put 50 people or 500 people in your venue, can you? So you usually can't. You know, what does the arrival look like? What does, you know, can you drop off 400 people at the front door? Maybe, maybe not. All of those things. So you're creating that sort of that seamless end-to-end experience. So I think that's really important. And then do you think that, you know, for the destinations who are, some destinations have specific incentive travel salespeople, but some don't. Some it's meetings and incentives, some it's meeting conventions, exhibitions and incentives, the full MICE experience. You know, some will have a sport and FIT, some will have, you know, so it's for the destinations, is it also understanding clearly, are you best at a sport, an FIT, an incentive travel, a meetings and conventions, really truly understanding what your destination is best at, is great at, is good at, and isn't quite ready for?
Yeah, that goes back to authenticity, right? And understanding who you are and who you aren't, right? And I mean, to your point, if we're talking about a major group, that maybe that primary itinerary that you've put together doesn't work best for that major group. But that goes back to me for pairing the correct audience with the best experience for them. So if you know your audience and it's going to be a group of 20, their itinerary is going to be completely different than a group of 200, right? And so understanding who the audience is and crafting the very best itinerary for that audience. But I think the point that I was making is if you have those benchmarks in place already, it gets a lot easier when somebody reaches out for incentive travel because you know, hey, for a group of 200, this is the best itinerary, especially if they have these interests. But like, for example, if I don't have great bird watching in my destination and a group wants to come do bird watching, you know, I'm going to say, hey, we're not the right place for this. And that's a hard thing to say when you're trying to make that sale, but it goes back to authenticity.
You know, that's, I love the bird watching example. So we have in Vancouver, if you were in Vancouver, you wouldn't say it has the best bird watching, but you can go 35 minutes away to Tawasin where there's a bird watching preserve. So again, that comes down to your destination, but now you have municipalities beside municipalities. A lot of super cities have this, right? So it's also, I think, about understanding the extension of your destination, like you did with Bryce Canyon. You know, talked about that's that extension of the destination, which is also, I think, a really valuable tool to have in your pocket, right? So we've been asked a tough question here. So Adam, so we're going to close with this because we've got 5 minutes left, but this is a good question. This is from Hassan, who is from our Turkey chapter. So he's been a destination management meeting planning organization for about 35 years there. So how much can associations similar to site, how much can we help to overcome the negative impact of a destination with questionable governments who are causing a huge negative PR of the perception for the destination?
Yeah, so for this one, it's kind of a unique answer, I think, because this is a challenging situation. But this is where you've got to use what I call more of a guerrilla tactic in your marketing. What I would do is I would bring in as many influencers as I could, people with large followings, major travel influencers. I would bring them in and I would video everything. I would get hours of amazing content with those influencers when they come in. And then I would not only share it on their platform, but I would use paid social media to push those and YouTube to push those videos out to my target persona. And hit them in their watering hole, I guess I'll say, you know. So, you know, if you're targeting ages 16 to 24 or 16 to 30, maybe you're creating amazing TikTok video content and you're using paid advertising to push that out within that persona, within the geographic location you're trying to get to. But I would use the video from the influencer's attendance to your destination because you have people that they've seen before and that they trust that may outperform the negative impact of the PR that's happened through traditional media channels because the younger audience is consuming media in a different way than the traditional media channels that might affect that older demographic. And I would say that that negative PR is going to have a much more negative effect on baby boomers than it will Gen X, millennials, and even Gen Z. I don't know if that's helpful, but from a tactical standpoint, I bring in several influencers, make great video content and cut up that video constantly and use paid advertising within the personas that I'm looking for to execute there.
I love that answer because it takes advantage of everything that we aren't always taking advantage of right now and need to be, you're right, doing a better job of doing that. So, and that's not the answer I would have given, which I also love. So that's fantastic.
Well, what answer would you have given, Tahira?
You know, I think that I would look at it through more of a, you know, an association lens and look at the advocacy work that we're doing. But it's difficult, you know, it is, to Hassan's point, it's a little bit of, you know, pushing water uphill against a big media machine. So being a bit more guerrilla about it is a great tactic and something that we should really be looking at using. We have, I would say every destination has a lot of great video content. So now it's about tying it to the influencers and the users and doing that again, doing it authentically with the influencers who have real followings, not bot followings.
Yeah.
and that do tie into your demographics. So we are.
Let me add one thing real quick, Tahira. Sorry, I'm going to add one thing real quick. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
This is why these associations, similar to Site, they'll have to have great relationships with the DMO or CVB, destination marketing organizations, so that they can partner on that content and bring in those influencers, because the association itself is going to have a hard time paying for all that content on their own. Anyway, I wanted to make sure I tied that off. You're absolutely right.
That is great. So we've talked about the Destination Marketing Podcast, your book, Touchpoints. Tell us how people can find you.
Yeah, I would say if you have more questions, the best way to get a hold of me is just my email, adam@relicagency.com. I put the link to find my book on Amazon if you want to get access to the book on Amazon. And you can also see our agency URL at relicagency.com.
Thank you so much, Adam. Truly a pleasure. You are so smart and entertaining and engaging. And those are all good things when you are watching a webinar.
I had a great time. Thank you very much for having me.